I want to welcome you to another episode of Beyond the Surface Radio. I'm your host, Dr. Wanda J. Evans Brewer. This afternoon, I'm seated to share with you about the preschool dropout. My 4.5-year-old, soon to be 5, as of July 16th, has announced to me that she does not want to go back to preschool. Now, this did not come out the blue. We've had, I would say, about maybe 5 or 6 months where she has vehemently protested every morning that she doesn't want to go to school. I'm a longtime teacher. I've taught every level, preschool, grammar school, high school, and now I teach at the collegiate level. So it's not uncommon to sort of just get academic weary, to just get tired of school. And it's not so much the being tired of learning, because we're learning every day. If we're really taking on life and, you know, enjoying it and getting out and exploring, and we have people that answer our questions, if we have a healthy mind for inquiry, we're actually learning every day. But this is more about people who begin to struggle in the structure of learning, where schools are put together where sometimes, you know, kids' spirits with learning, and adults as well, we just get kind of bored, or we feel unchallenged, or disinterested, or sometimes it's the instruction that just becomes just sort of routine and cumbersome. So nonetheless, my daughter is one of those people. Even at 4.5, she has protested for months that she does not want to go to school. Now, she's not saying she doesn't want to go to school because she doesn't like her friends. She loves her friends. She tells me, she comes home and tells me different stories about various characters in her classroom, most of them more than entertaining. What she's saying is that, and this is to quote her, I said, why don't you want to go to school? She said, all they want me to do is homework every day. This is a preschool that sends home Xerox worksheets, and the worksheets are various letters, and she's supposed to trace the letter and practice writing out the letter, both upper and lower case, and there's usually something to color, and she's gotten bored with it. Now, I don't know if you know, but Marva Collins, the educator from Chicago who had the foresight to take her pension, which was about $5,000, take her 2-flat and convert it into her own school here, was an ardent, like she was just adamantly against worksheets. And so when she finally evolved her school to the level of its own building, one of the things she forbade was that her teachers ever pull out worksheets. She saw it as just busy work. She did not believe in it. She didn't believe that it really reinforced learning, that it increased critical thinking skills. She was adamant about that. And I have to say, after all these years, when I think back, I was an early reader. I don't really remember me really learning a whole bunch from a worksheet. It was good for repetition, and it was good for practicing dexterity when you're learning to write, just getting your hands to make the shapes and follow the lines and learn to stay in the lines. But in terms of just like new learning, new ideas, being able to reason better, I can't really attribute that to worksheets at all. So nonetheless, my daughter hates them. As soon as you pull one out, like, she'll go and she'll do that. Now, I have to tell you, she's a highly intelligent little girl. And even my other children will tell you, she's very, very smart. And she is very much a language-oriented person, meaning that her greatest strength is in speaking. She's a great speaker. She has the memory of an elephant. And she does actually connect the dots well. Her critical thinking skills, her ability to really sort of analyze something and synthesize it and make sense of it, she just naturally has that skill. What she doesn't want to do is the routine, the burdensome practice of being seated, which is sort of confining for her, and having to go through, you know, tracing letters and coloring things, and because she's more rump and tumble, she's more sort of kinesthetically charged. So she likes hands-on activities. Now, I'm not really mad at her. I'm sort of sad for her, because there is a whole level of preschool kids who are suffering from school burnout. And they're burnt out because a lot of the stuff that kindergarten is positioned to teach them, they've already been exposed to in preschool. And so when you talk about repeat, now you're talking about repeat, plus 3-peat, and in some cases 4-peat, depending on what time, at what point did you enter your kid into preschool. Now, I've never faced this challenge. This is my first time facing this challenge. I have 3 other children, but they weren't preschool children. She's really my first preschool kid. And so it just breaks your heart when your kid tells you every single day, they wake up, do I have to go to school? I don't want to go to school. All they want me to do is homework. I don't want to do homework. I want to be able to do a little of that. I want to play with my friends. I want to go outside. I want to explore. And all this stuff, you know, the stuff that she's actually asking to do, there are schools that are structured to have a lot of balance, that they do that. One of the things I find interesting is that most of the preschools are set up based off of Jean Piaget. He's known for learning through play. He's the theorist that came up with the various stages of development for children from 0. His theory kind of cuts off at about 7 or 8 years old. But one of the things that he offers us is the concept that children actually do a lot of learning through play. And so one of the reasons that preschools have the 4 areas, you know, they always have a reading area, and then they'll have a table where there's manipulatives, and then they'll have an area where, you know, they'll have a rug where it's time to just like dance and sing and play. And then, you know, you have an area where they work with puzzles, where, you know, now you're getting off it, they work with blocks. And so there's always a kitchen or fire station or all those big toys where their imagination can run wild. So part of that structure is there in preschools to encourage learning through play. So I know that my daughter is not hitting those stations because she kind of complains about it. So she dropped out. I had to support her in it. I finally got to a point. I mean, I was, you know, giving her force. We was doing trickery. We was bribing. We was coming up with all kind of stuff to get this girl out the door. But the bottom line is, it got to the point every single morning she was, you know, she went from protesting to being angry to just simply crying and just saying, look, I just don't want to go. And I finally looked at my husband and I talked to my mom and I said, you know, I'm not going to send her. I have to take in consideration my daughter's spirit, that something, they're doing something wrong. And I've sat and talked with a couple of the teachers before and said to them, you know, I've looked at their structure. It is pretty boring. It's a lot of seated time. It's a, you know, and then you come off of winter, you know, because we're in the Midwest where you can't go outside, you can't run and play. And so one of the things I had offered them, my husband is first generation Jesse White Tumblr, and he was willing and at one point was allowed to offer tumbling classes for about a half an hour. He would have done more, but they limited him to a half an hour once a week. And the kids loved it. I mean, they loved it. When Mr. Chester showed up, they couldn't wait to do this and that. And they was excited, and they did their flips and they did their cartwheels and I mean, they absolutely loved it. And for some reason, when they got a new manager, a new director there, she decided she didn't want to keep the program because she didn't like the mats. She was worried about beautification, and so the mats were burdensome to her. And she kept saying, oh, we got to figure out what we're going to do with these mats, instead of recognizing you have a world-renowned gymnastic champion that's for free is willing to come in and give your kids really what it amounts to as a brain break. Like, let them burn some steam. At the end of the day, they're actually toddlers. And I don't know if my listeners know, but you know, in the scientific world, we know that being a toddler goes up to the age of 6, that they still need that to burn that steam, and recess actually allows a kid to sort of reset themselves so that they can receive more. Very, very, very good for helping kids refocus and take in actually more if you're trying to teach them. So to make a long story short, that was eliminated. So it was just a long winter with minimum movement and lots of treats, you know, all this stuff. St. Patty's Day, green treats. Valentine's Day, more treats. Easter, more treats. And so not only have I noticed that my daughter's weight has increased, but, you know, it was a little bit of that hyper added to it, and then just that moodiness, because whether or not we want to admit it or not, sugar spikes. It spikes us. And so she just didn't want to go. She said, you know, even for the treats, even for the friendship. And she began to stay in trouble every day. Well, I got in trouble because I couldn't take a nap. Well, we know that if you allow kids to burn off some steam, they rest well. Well, I got in trouble because they said I didn't want to do the activities. Well, you know, 10 minutes of an activity for a toddler is one thing. 20 minutes, a half an hour gets to be quite a lot. Just every day. And I start telling my husband, I said, she can't be in trouble every day. I wouldn't want to go to my job and be in trouble every day. I wouldn't want to go to school and be in trouble every day. I wouldn't even want to come home and know I was in trouble every day. And then I guess like the tipping point for me was when she couldn't take the nap. And there was another little girl that couldn't take the nap as well. And so she laid down, they dimmed the lights, you know, and naps in preschool run 2 hours. And that's really time for teachers to prepare and get stuff together and set up a snack. And she wasn't walking around or anything. She just couldn't sleep. And because she didn't sleep, they didn't allow her to have a little boy's birthday cake and ice cream. And the little boy is like a really good friend of my daughter's. And so her punishment was this parent had brought in this cake and ice cream. They kept it from her. And I thought, wow, this isn't even being, you know, something that the school put together. You know, they took that from her. And that was so unfair where the punishment didn't even connect to the crime. The punishment just did not connect to the crime. It was just, I said, wow, they don't even have a real behavior modification program in place. They're definitely not focused on being encouraging, trying to encourage her behavior. And I felt really, really offended. And so I said, you know what? It's just time. So my daughter's a preschool dropout. And she's been home with me, I want to say, about 4 weeks. And I want to tell you that it was the best choice I could have ever made. Now, of course, the same way she had to calibrate, I had to calibrate. And I still ask her every day, you ready to go back to school? Nope. Do you miss blah, blah, blah? She has a couple of friends that she misses, but she does not miss them enough to go back to school. And to quote her, she says, I never ever want to go back. I just don't. I'd rather stay home with you. And so I've had to readjust my day, my flow, my energy. But you know what? She's so worth it. And a lot of the little bitty things that she was doing that aggravated me, some of the behavior acting out, her mimicking, getting smart, being bossy, many of those behaviors, to my surprise, have rapidly disappeared. I said, she was really the same way adults. We're at these toxic places and the toxic stuff just starts to grate us. And so we find ourselves irritated other places and being rude and mean in the grocery line and fussing at our spouse. And, you know, we wake up mad, we go to bed mad, lunch is nasty, everything is cynical. I said, wow, that actually trickles down to little ones. So I got me a partner. We wake up, we have tea together. That's one thing. She has cereal. I have coffee, but she has tea. When I move, she moves, just like that. And there are times that I have to figure out where, if I can get another set of hands to watch her for a little while. I usually have to cut a deal with her to be able to skate out and do a couple of things without her. But for the most part, she has been joyous to be around because, to make a long story short, she's happy. We do some reading together. We recently did some bike riding together. She's with me when I go to the store. We make decisions about what we'll have for lunch and dinner. I've allowed her to be my partner as we clean up and straighten up. She's my trusty assistant with my mother. I have a little baby I babysit. She's my trusty assistant with him. And I'm looking at her shine. And so part of why I'm sharing this podcast is that there's some parent out there with some kid that is complaining about their daycare setting. And I want you to take their little spirit seriously. They are, you know, definitely aware of joy, of sadness. They know when they're accepted. They know when they're loved. My husband had one morning, and it really concerned me when he dropped my daughter off. And we thought that she was going to be a part of the kindergarten graduation because they're preparing for that and they were asking for fees. And so he took the money to pay the fee. And it turns out that there is they actually are licensed to be a kindergarten. So it wasn't for the preschoolers who were going off to kindergarten, but rather for the kindergartners who would be moving on to first grade. And so they said, oh, no, you know, you don't have to pay the fee. You know, she's not graduating. So he said, okay. And then the lady said, one of the teachers, who's actually not my daughter's direct teacher, says, oh, she wouldn't be graduating anyway. She doesn't like learning. And so my husband, who is, you know, pretty reserved, kind of quiet guy, you can get slide a lot past him. You know, he had to let her know about herself. He said, well, first of all, my daughter is very intelligent. The problem with her here is she's bored. And I looked at the teachers like, you know, and this is no stab at anyone, you know, that's suffering from obesity. It's too much estrogen in there. There's no male teachers. And everyone's fat except for one teacher. Like, there's one lady who's thin, but she's a skinny fat. You know, meaning that she doesn't do a lot of movement. And then there's an older woman who she's thin too, but it's that old kind of, I've aged into a skinny fat. I said, these are not even women that's excited about movement and activities and being stimulating. And, you know, so that's why a lot of the curriculum is structured toward seat work, sitting down, don't get up, don't say much, singing song. Like it's just boring. And I did what you're supposed to do as a parent, popped in at an odd time. You know, I've gone to all of their posts and activities. We've participated. And that's not to say they haven't done some a couple of fun things, but the overall flow of the day is such that it has grimed my daughter's spirit. Now, here's what I want you to know as I wrap up this podcast. There's a theorist, Howard Gardner. And he has identified 8 intelligences. And so when you look at your children, you have to recognize that the only way to display intelligence isn't just through reading and writing. So we have oral, we have visual, we have tactile. That's where you get a kinesthetic, where you get kids that can flip and jump and hop and dance, and they are contortionists. Then you have kids who are interpersonal. They really are good talking. So they're little social butterflies in the room. You have intrapersonal people, kids and people who just understand self. They understand how they're made up. They understand the spirit of things. And then you have naturalists. You know, these are young people that are comfortable with outdoors. Maybe they're excellent with animals. They're just really good with nature. You also have mathematic logical. You know, these are kids that are excellent counters, or they're very good with reasoning. And so a lot of times schools only focus in on a couple of the intelligences, which leave other kids kind of hanging. So if like music, mathematical, if your strength is in music and they only sing 2 songs a day, you know, your spirit might be a little low. If your strength is in math and everything is reading, reading, reading and writing, 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 you might not have as great of a day. And it's the same for kids who enjoy movement, who need to move. So I'm sharing that with you. Again, his name is Howard Gardner, so that you understand that, you know, because your kid doesn't necessarily adapt to that environment, it doesn't make them dumb. It doesn't make them any less bright. It doesn't make them any less intelligent. The school may not be structured to feed into their intelligences, so it seems like they're not growing, in which case it's your charge. It's your responsibility to either homeschool them or to find a school that fits them so that they can get the best out of learning too. Because at the end of the day, if you don't, then you get kids that fade away. Now, my daughter has just dropped out, but she has been more excited about learning than a little. I can't say that if I kept her there, how she would feel, because I do want her to feel excited about kindergarten. I am worried because letters and numbers and writing and seat work is coming back again. And I promise you, they probably gonna have some Xerox papers. But on the same token, because she's gotten a bit of a brain break and I'm allowing her to be stimulated some other ways, I may have salvaged her soul. I may have saved her. I believe I have. I really, really do. And I'm going to tell you who else got saved in this whole process. I did. I need to stay in tune with my kid. This is my kid. I've known her since in vitro. Whether she's happy or sad in the day, that matters to me. And it is a small sacrifice at this stage to give up some of the comforts and leisures to cater to her, to avoid the huge sacrifice that often comes with when they become adolescents. So these are just some words of wisdom. In any case, you've been listening to Beyond the Surface Radio, and I'm your host, Dr. Wanda J. Evans Brewer. And until we chat again, be safe in God's grace.